All right, guys, let's get going. I want to welcome you to the Bottom Line group of Alcoholics Anonymous. This is our regular Tuesday evening step meeting. And my name is Jim, and I am an alcoholic. Hi, everybody. I'm glad to see all of you here. This is a closed meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. We ask that you silence your cell phones and pagers at this time, and please refrain from cursing when you share. Now, I'm not too sure how those all three tie together. Maybe it's because I find I regularly have to curse at my cell phone. Could I please have three volunteers to clean up after the meeting? I want to see about 10 hands. That's one, two, three. There's two from there and one. Okay, that's good. Please join me in a moment of silent meditation, and we'll say the Serenity Prayer together. Thank you, Serenity Prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Amen. Okay, do we have anyone here tonight who's been out improving their resume or doing further intensive research and is just coming back? Give us your first name, please. Yes, sir.
Tommy, alcoholic.
Hey, Tommy, we're glad you're here. Let's give Tommy a hand. Miracle to be back, Tommy. Glad you're here. Anyone here for their very first ever AA meeting? We just want to know who you are so we can leap all over you after the meeting and give you the word. I'm just kidding. Anybody new? How about visitors? You got any visitors tonight? Yes, sir.
My name is Fred. I'm an alcoholic.
Where are you from, Fred? Which beach group? Oh, the Pompano Beach group. That one that's upstairs? Above the deli?
Yeah.
Okay. And what's your name, Tom?
Fred.
Oh, Fred, yeah. Your story's in the big book, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Oh, that's what I thought, yeah. Well, we're glad you're here. Give Fred a hand. See, we're a very friendly group here, Fred. So.
Jim, that's not the group that threw us out on Thursday night, was it?
Yeah, they did. Yeah, they didn't throw me out. They threw Tom out. They wouldn't let him run his machine, so we left. Okay. This is the definition of Alcoholics Anonymous, or the preamble, or if you really study the history of AA, you know that this is what was presented to the post office department by the Grapevine at the time of their incorporation as a non-profit association to get franking privileges on their mailing of the Grapevine. And this was taken directly from the application to the post office department, where they said that Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength, and hope with each other. They may solve their common problem and help others recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for a membership. We are self-supporting through our own contributions. And AA is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organization, or institution. It's not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober, help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. And Bill Wilson wrote in the literature that the primary purpose of an Alcoholics Anonymous group is the teaching and practice of the 12 steps. And that's, of course, what we're doing here tonight. Kathy, were you here last week? Steve did 6 and 7, did he? Good, thank you. All right. I was driving up here tonight from Hallandale. And some kind of, you know, sort of a drag. And I was thinking back, and I was trying to dredge up something that had occurred way, way back when I first got sober. It was a joke. It finally came to me. I was blessed. I had two wonderful sponsors when I first came in. Father Joe, who had been one of the original 100, and Bud Scholes, who came in the early 40s and was sponsored by Bill Wilson. And Father Joe used to like to tell stories about Catholics and clergy and stuff. And he was talking about that, and he said, you know, there's a story that goes around about this priest who was had a little trouble with the bottle. In fact, he got drunk a lot. But he liked to play golf. And it was his habit when he went out to the golf course that he would have the youngest novitiate nun in the convent caddy for him. So the nun would be dragging his clubs and he'd be out there shooting golf. He was out one day and it was kind of a cloudy day. And he shot under the first green, and he was right about 3 feet from the cup, and he took the putt, and he missed. And he said, "Damn it! Missed!" And the nun was horrified. She said, "Father, that is wrong. God will punish you." Never mind. Second hole, he's about a foot and a half away from the cup. Took a putt. Missed. "Damn it! Missed again! Father, you mustn't say such things. God will punish you." Third hole, he's about a half a foot away. Couldn't miss. He missed. "Damn it! Missed again." And the nun was about to say something when there was this great bolt of lightning that came flying down out of the clouds. "Stop!" Hit the nun. Crispy critter. And this big voice came down from the heavens, "Damn it, missed again." Oh, yes, okay. Now, tonight we're going to take a look at the eighth and ninth steps. A week ago tonight, I apologize. I don't apologize. I have real good excuse. I was in New York. And I was attending a meeting of the Mustard Seed group up there in Midtown. Nice group. Really strong group. But boy, were they ever organized. Man, they had that thing organized down to the last half second. One after another, and everybody knew what they were supposed to do. It was like watching a choreographed play. It was beautiful. In any event, last week you took a look at the sixth and seventh step. I'd like to, if I may, just briefly review for you where we are now. Let's look at these steps and see how they all fit together, because there's a pattern here that's critically important for us to understand. It starts with the fourth step. And in the fourth step, we're going to be doing something which is going to be with us the rest of our lives. It will determine, in effect, the course of our lives, because we're going to find out when we do our fourth step what's wrong with us. We're going to find out what it is in us that blocks us off from God. And, of course, that's utterly critical, because being blocked from God, we have no chance to recover. Remember, we always go back to basics. The basic fact is that we're powerless alcoholics. We can't stop drinking on our own. If we don't stop, we die. The only chance we have is to put a loving God between us and the booze. To do that, we have to be cleared of the things that block us. And so, when we get to the fourth step, we're going to find out what it is that's blocking us from God. There are four cardinal defects identified in the fourth step, identified again in the tenth step, and again in the 11th step. Just four: selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. Please notice that none of those bear any resemblance whatsoever to sin. There's no mention of sin, deadly or otherwise. because we're not making those kinds of judgments of ourselves or of others. We're going to leave that up to God. What we are recognizing is that these defects of character are such that they block us from the sunlight of the Spirit. And being blocked from the sunlight of the Spirit, we have no protection, because remember again that as alcoholics, we are powerless over that first drink. It's going to get us. It doesn't matter how badly we want sobriety. It doesn't matter how strongly we resist. Sooner or later, without God's protection, we drink again. And for us to drink is to die. And so in the fourth step, we're going to look to see what it is that blocks us off from God. And in the four parts of the fourth step, we look at resentments. We look at dishonesty, selfishness, and fear. Again, we look at fear. Again, we look at resentment. We look at selfishness and dishonesty. And when we have finished doing this, we've also identified the people we've harmed by our conduct over the years past and have become willing to make amends to them all. If that sounds like the eighth step, of course, that's exactly what it is. The eighth step is substantially done in the fourth step. Now, having gathered together as a result of our inventory, an inventory or a list of our defects of character, we're then ready to move into the next step, which is the fifth step. And in the fifth step, we're going to admit these things to another human being, as well as to ourselves and to God. And in the admission, we're going to experience some tremendous changes in ourselves. It is in the fifth step that the humility that we need will come to us, and the honesty that we need will come to us, and the fearlessness that we need. And in the fifth step, we will experience, most of us, the beginnings, sometimes very strong beginnings of a spiritual awakening. And our fears fall from us. In fact, we have, in the fifth step, we have many of the promises coming true. Now, by the way, don't wait for the ninth step. That's a misnomer. The promises are coming true as we go through the steps. When we get to the sixth and seventh steps, now then, this is the culmination at this point of everything we've learned about our defects of character. We need to examine what we've learned. We've learned that we have no power over these. We can't get rid of them ourselves. The big book's already told us that, but now we really, really see it. We see that these defects are cancerous, they're killers, they're wiping us out. They account for our failures. These are the things which have kept us sick, and a major part of our illness, of our insanity, is directly attributable to these defects of character, which really are the natural God-given instincts that we carry with us from birth, which have been warped and perverted by fear. We see that these are killers. We see that we can't get rid of them ourselves. We remember that back there in the second step, we came to believe that God could restore us to sanity. So now in the fifth step, it becomes clear to us that this is where that belief system must apply. Then now we're going to need to turn to God for help to be free of these insanities. And then we have to look and make sure that we truly wish to be set free from these things. And in almost every instance, this will happen. Which means that after we have completed our fifth step, we've gone through the hour, which is set forth in detail on page 75 in our book. We take that hour to review everything we've done, to make sure that we haven't left anything out, and to make sure that we're ready now to go forward with 6 and 7 and 8 and 9. When we look then at the sixth step, we must look at the sixth step as it really is, not as it has been twisted around and made into a cult symbol by some of the New Age AA people, and especially people with some kind of an axe to grind, especially a commercial axe. Because when the big book was written, there was no six-step extant at the time. When Bill sat down to write out what became 12 steps, between the fifth and the seventh step, he identified what happened. What happened was that they had become entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character by virtue of the fact that they have identified them in their fourth step and they have admitted them and articulated them in their fifth step. And so the sixth step is framed as a past participle. We were entirely ready, it says. It doesn't say anything about we made ourselves ready. There's not a scintilla of evidence, not one word, not even a breath that would suggest that we are to work on our defects, that we are to put quarters in parking meters or drive the speed limit or brush our teeth with our left hand, assuming that we're right-handed, or do all of these kinds of crazy things that are floating around now as some sort of a test or working toward what? I don't know. Because if I've done my fourth and fifth step right, I'm already ready. What in the hell am I waiting for? Do I want to be rid of these defects or don't I? I know people that sit on that sixth step for a year. Incredible. Some people are instructed that they're to keep a jar. And in this jar, they are to have a whole bunch of poker chips or little round cut-out circles or even just pages from a notebook. And on each page, there will be a defect to work on that day. So you reach in the jar, you pull out the defect, and you say, okay, today I work on this defect. And when somebody asks me or tells me about working on their defects, I ask them, how do you do that? How do you work on something over which you have no power? Well, of course, some people go even further, because there will be, for every 7 days in there, there'll be one that's put in there by the sponsor. And this is the biggie. This is one you really have to work on. You can't do your seven-step prayer. You're not ready. Now, what is the solution to this unreadiness which is presented to us by the big book? It's so simple, guys. What it tells us is that if by some chance we're unwilling to let go of something, the sole and single remedy for this condition is to pray for the willingness till it comes. That's it. That's it. We don't move on until the willingness comes. The big book does not ever indulge itself in instructions which are directly contrary to what it's already told us. It tells us on the one hand we're powerless over these defects. Do you think it would be stupid enough to tell us to work on something that we're powerless over? Of course not. So we take this very simple little step, which is simply, all it does is to show the transition between the fifth and the seventh step, and we make a year's worth of control out of it. It's weird, man. And you know what it does? And this is, as most of you know, I've been doing meetings here for a while, so you know I'm pretty passionate about this stuff. But I see people die because they're not being given proper sponsorship, because they're trying to follow some false trails. The question is, how soon do you want to get well? Not how assiduously are you following the false trails laid down by some Hazleton guide or some Joe and Charlie nonsense or this over here or something that some counselor down here in a treatment center wrote out to get their master's degree. Because all of the instructions are right there in the book. All you got to do is follow them. The seventh step is likewise extraordinarily simple. It is a prayer. It is a prayer. Now, the problem with the seventh step has nothing to do with the prayer itself. The prayer of the seventh step, by the way, is almost identical to the third step prayer. Ask for exactly the same things. But there's one major difference. When we took our third step, we didn't know what was wrong with us, did we? But now, in the seventh step, we have done our inventory, we have done our fifth step, we know what the problems are. So now when we ask God to remove all of our defects, all of them, that stand in the way of our usefulness to God and our fellows, we know what they are. Now we speak from knowledge. Remember that the way the steps are set up, there's first there's stuff that we have to do. And then God does what he promises. First we do what we're supposed to do, then God does what he promises. And this goes on and on and on for the rest of our lives. And here's a perfect example of that. We had to first find and admit what's wrong with us. Then we take these things to God, and then we can believe and expect that God will remove them, because that's the promise, and it happens to be true. What's so hard about that? The seventh step hasn't anything more to do with humility, for example, than any other prayer. One would hope that we offer up every prayer humbly. Why is it that humility has become the bottom line of the seventh step? Well, it's only because that's what we're told in the 12 and 12, a chapter that was basically written by Father Ed, who was a Catholic Jesuit priest, had his own agenda to promulgate. Bill at that time was a very sick man. When Bill 4 or 5 years later wrote a whole article on humility, which was published in the Grapevine, 7 pages, not once did he mention the seventh step. Now, these Arkansas boys are, I always thought they were Texas. Howie, my dear friend Howie's always correcting me on something. And tonight he came to me with another correction, that these guys were not from Texas who wrote the principles behind the steps. They were from Arkansas. And I told him, Howie, I know that they were just over the line. And they just made this stuff up. And now it goes around as if it were gospel. What'd they say? The seventh step, the principle behind the seventh step is humility. Well, you say, oh, well, sure, that it must be, because look, it's right there in the 12 and 12. The problem, there are many problems with that. The most important one is that when we read the big book, we find that humility is what we learn in the fifth step, not the seventh step. And so when we look at the seventh step prayer, we have to understand, guys, that we're petitioning God to do exactly what we ask him to do back in the third step. Take away my difficulties, we ask him. In the third step, that victory over them may bear witness to those I would help of thy love, thy power, thy way of life. In the seventh step, we ask him to remove all those defects of character which stand in the way of our usefulness to him and our fellows. Same thing exactly. Now, there's a big problem with the seventh step these days, because new age AAers are running around these rooms these days saying, oh, God doesn't take all your defects. Why would you say that? To be a wise guy? To sound super smart? To be a little bit cynical? Don't we understand that every time we put limitations on God's power, that's the only limit that there ever can be, and that limit only applies to us? If I want to limit God's power to work in my life, I have to approach my relationship with him on a less than trusting basis. I have to reduce my faith. And I have to do that by saying, well, God won't take away all my defects. You know, I can tell you why they do this. Because they've got a screwy idea about the 10th step. somehow or another they think the 10th step is there because God doesn't take away all my defects in the 7th step. Somehow lets them linger on, and then I get over here in the 10th step and I get to work on them some more. And the 10th step doesn't come from that at all. Not at all. The 10th step is there simply and solely because the world and all of its people will continue to threaten us while we're out there living our lives. And because of that, because of the threat will create fear, and fear creates the recurrence of our defects. We have defects that continue to crop up, and we got to take care of them every day as they come up. That's why we have a 10th step. It's got nothing to do with the 7th step. And so if we go into the 7th step understanding and in faith that God is not only powerful enough, and we already agreed to that back in the 2nd step, remember? What we agreed to, came to believe that God could restore us to sanity. No equivocation there. Not holding anything back there. Just saying a flat statement. He can. In other words, I'm saying he has the power to do this. And if somehow or another, then I've decided that God plays tricks on us. God wants to test us. All this stuff. Instead of saying God can and will, and I believe it, and I trust it, and my life is going to be based on faith every day, 24 hours a day. Because ultimately that's where all of us are headed. And so the 7th step prayer is the prayer which is the prayer for removal of those defects of character which we have identified in our 4th step, admitted in our 5th step, those defects of character which stand in the way between us and God, that block us from the sunlight of the Spirit, those same defects of character that keep us insane and sick and drunk. And any limitations on God's power that we insist upon inserting into that equation, shame on us. Now then, on page 76 in your big book, we're going to take a look at the 8th step. I'd also like you, if you will, please, to turn you back to page 70. Just keep your finger in 76, turn back to 70. 70. Page 70 is at the tail end of the 4th step. We have already determined that in the 4th step we are going to be identifying the people we have harmed by our conduct, and that we are likewise going to become willing to set matters straight where we can. Now, on page 70, 4 lines up from the bottom of that page, the big book reiterates this position so there can be no mistake that the 8th step is being done as we do our 4th step. We have listed the people we have hurt by our conduct and are willing to straighten out the past if we can. Pure 8th step, isn't it? So there can be no mistake that this is exactly what has happened four steps back from the 8th step. The 8th step, with the exception of anybody we need to add because they weren't picked up in the 4th step, and that happens once in a while. Other than that, the 8th step is done. Let's see what it tells us on page 76. It could not be more clear. We're going to go to this third full paragraph, which begins about the middle of the page. Now we need more action, without which we find that faith without works is dead. That phrase, by the way, which is taken from many religious writings, especially, of course, in the case of the big book from the Bible, we find that exact phrase in some of the versions of the book of James. Faith without works is dead. And it's sometimes I think we hear it so often that we don't stop to think what it means. Faith obviously therefore is not a state of mind. It's not something which just simply exists as a bunch of electrons running around in our head in collision with each other. faith that is not acted upon, faith which does not translate into active trust, is dead. And so, again, we're reminded, faith without works is dead. We first heard this all the way back in Bill's story. And remember how it came about, because Bill had been given the inspiration to understand and believe that he was going to have to take this message he'd been given and carry it out to others, that it was critically important for him to do that. And when he talked to his friend Ebby about it, and Ebby agreed, and that's when Ebby said to him, "Yes, Bill, faith without works is dead. It doesn't matter how much faith you've acquired by working these steps. If you don't go out and carry them to the next person, you'll die with it. That faith will not sustain you." Let's look at steps 8 and 9. We have a list of all persons we've harmed and to whom we are willing to make amends. We made it when we took inventory. That's pretty clear, isn't it? And if you pick up any of these printed forms that are running around, ask yourself how many of them even come close to recognizing that as one of the critical elements of a four-step. You'll begin to see just how shabby those things really are. We subjected ourselves to a drastic self-appraisal. That was the fourth step and the fifth step. Now keep in mind how critically important that is, because all this stuff relates back and forth. You know, this, the big book is a potpourri of information and principles and doctrine and dicta and philosophy, all of which is like a fine mosaic, and it all ties together. And everything ties back with everything else. We subjected ourselves to a drastic self-appraisal. When Kim read chapter 5 tonight, were you listening? Do you know what she read? Seldom, rarely have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed our path. Those who do not recover are people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program, usually men and women who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. This business of a critical self-appraisal is bottom line stuff. This is down where it really lives for us. People who are unable or unwilling to be thoroughly honest with themselves don't make it in here. And it requires courage, you know, to do that. Sissies don't make it in AA. People who cannot face themselves don't make it here. This is right down where we live. Being honest with ourselves, maybe for the very first time in our entire lives. And by the way, when you hear people talk about this being an honest program, translate that to mean this is a program which requires self-honesty, first and foremost. And not just to do the fourth and fifth step, but every time we pick up our notebook, every time we become willing to be self-aware as we go through every day of our lives, and when we retire at night, we have to be willing to be honest with ourselves, because otherwise we're not going to know what the hell's going on with us. We're not going to know what our present reality is, and we will be therefore unable to deal with these things as they come up. Now we go out to our fellows and repair the damage done in the past. We attempt to sweep away the debris which is accumulated out of our effort to live on self-will and to run the show ourselves. See how that ties back? Ties right back to the third step, doesn't it? Ties right back to the third step. Remember, we got the third step, what the big book told us? It was talking about the half measures group out there, I think. It told us that our problems, our troubles, we think of our own making, that they arise out of ourselves, that the alcoholic is an extreme example of self-will run riot. Talks about the fact that our troubles have arisen as a result of decisions we have made based on self. That's on page 62. And at the bottom of page 62, as we examine all this, what do we find? We find that we have been trying to play God all our lives. We've been trying to dictate our lives, dictate the results of our lives. And we found out that we've been trying to play God and it didn't work. And therefore, we made a decision. And the big book says, therefore we decided that hereafter in this drama of life, God would be our director. He is the principal, we are his agent. He is the father, we are his child. And that's the third step. You see where it comes from. And we see that here on page 76, where it's talking about the debris which is accumulated out of our effort to live on self-will and to run the show ourselves. And it's not varying at all from what we've already learned. That all these problems, all this debris that's accumulated, all this stuff which has been the result of the kind of life we've been leading up till now, is the result of our own self-will, of decisions based on self, and our trying to run the show to suit ourselves. And this is a bitter pill to swallow for people who want an excuse for their crapped out behavior, not only in the past, but for now, forevermore. Give me any excuse that will allow me to do as I damn well please. Give me an excuse which will mean I don't have to take responsibility for the things that have happened, that I don't have to take responsibility for my life. I get to blame it on alcoholism. I get to blame it on dysfunctional families. I get to blame it on this and blame it on that. And I can even get some people to listen to me when I blame it on God. And therefore, I've got the perfect out. And here again, the big book is so insistent, we must listen to this, which has accumulated out of our effort to live on self-will and run the show ourselves. All this debris, everything. And when we understand that, then we have a major leg up on recovery, don't we? Because now we're going to attack the problem at its root. The root is us and our insanity and our selfishness and our self-will and our self-pity. And we have to be rid of that self or it'll kill us. Why? Because it blocks us from God irrevocably. We are blocked from the sunlight of the Spirit when we're trying to live our lives in self. And without God in our lives, we don't have a chance. If we haven't the will to do this, we ask until it comes. Notice here, the sole remedy in the eighth step for the willingness to make amends is to pray for the willingness until it comes. Just exactly the same remedy as in the sixth step. If we're unwilling to turn over a defect of character, we pray for the willingness till it comes. Here in the eighth step, we pray for the willingness until it comes. We don't move on until that happens. But there's something really magical about a prayer for willingness, and a lot of us learned it way back when. Yeah. Remember when we learned and we came in here perhaps scared to death of God, maybe self-proclaimed atheists or agnostics, and our sponsors, the ones that know what the hell they're doing, said, looky here. The only requirement here is that you be willing to believe that there just might be a power out there greater than yourself. That's where it all begins. But how do I go about that? Well, you pray for the willingness. But what if I don't believe? Doesn't matter. Pray for it anyway. Pray to whom it may concern if it makes you feel good. Pray to God if you're there, if it makes you feel better. Bill Wilson said it for us, clear as a bell. He said, I learned I had to pray just as if there were a God. And then when the miracles started coming, I could no longer deny that they came from a power greater than myself. That's when faith came. And faith was the greatest gift of all, he said. So we do the same thing. But what there's a byproduct here. We learn way back there that when we pray for willingness, we get it. You got to be careful. You pray for willingness, you're going to get it. So you see what that kind of puts us in this circular thing, you know. If I got to be willing to get willing before I pray for willingness, right? So a good sponsor will say, don't bother me with that kind of stuff, kid, just pray. And if you don't know what to pray, here it is. I wrote it out for you. Because you see, God doesn't care who wrote out the prayer. God only cares who says the prayer. Remember, it was agreed at the beginning we would go to any lengths for victory over alcohol. And this applies now in spades directly to this whole question of making amends in the ninth step. Now, a lot of people coming in here are appalled by the fourth step, terrified of the fifth step, and absolutely are going to refuse to do the ninth step. Because this can go directly to pride, directly to sense of shame and remorse, having to face the people we've harmed, having to be willing to make amends. Some people coming in the door have done some horrendous things out there. Maybe have believed that they can never, ever make amends. That they'd be shot on sight if they try, and on and on and on. There's all different permutations of this same problem. And so there is a great reluctance among many to make the amends. However, we don't recover if we don't. Now let's examine why that should be. There's nothing esoteric or metaphysical about this. It's very simple. We are as blocked off from God by our guilt and remorse and shame as we are by our defects of character. Now, how is it that we're going to be free of guilt in working the steps? It's the ninth step. The ninth step is that step which miraculously, magically releases us from guilt and allows us, therefore, to move on into the realm of the Spirit and to have a spiritual awakening. But we must do it. We must. Those who balk at the ninth step don't recover. Guaranteed. They may hang around for a while, but eventually that guilt will eat them alive. And so when we look at the ninth step, we don't look at it as something which is optional. It is utterly required and important. We must do it. And what about this business of making amends? Is this going to be a lifetime undertaking? Yes, in many respects it may well be. Especially where it involves family, for example. We may need to be on the amends trail for years and years, maybe for the rest of our lives. Not running around abjectly, hanging our head and saying we're sorry 1,000 times a week. That doesn't work anyway. But by living that kind of life, which clearly shows our remorse and our desire to do better, is it going to be necessary for us to make all of the amends we've identified in our four step before we can move on to 10, 11, and 12? No. No. You see, the big book never sets up a standard which is impossible, does it? Think about it for a second. If it may take me a lifetime to make amends in some cases, and I can't work 10, 11, and 12 until I've completed those, that would be utterly foolish, wouldn't it? And so the big book does not require that at all. It does require, however, that we be willing to make those amends. That's the bottom line. Because there are going to be amends we can't make. There are going to be amends that we are forbidden to make, because in doing so we would harm someone else. And we're not permitted to do anything to harm another human being. There may be amends we can't make because of geography, or because the person is dead or moved away or can't be found. Are we going to be saddled with the guilt for the rest of our lives? Surely not. Because again, the requirement is that we be willing to make amends if we can. And that's what sets us free. But this has to be a real willingness, not just something we mouth. You remember when you first got in here, you weren't sure about this alcoholism business. You said, "My name is Jim, I'm an alcoholic." And everybody said, "Oh boy, you must be one of us." Maybe I didn't know whether I was or not. It didn't matter. We can't do that with the ninth step. This is going to have to be something that we have fully committed ourselves. That if, as, and when we can make that amends, we're going to do it, come hell or high water. And there are some amends which are real, real monsters. Not everybody has those. Some people have pretty much pedestrian type amends. Even though I must say that in most cases, what would appear to you and me as being not any kind of a big deal could have been built up in their heads to a point where they're monsters as well. And so we're going to treat these amends as being of supreme importance, regardless of how they might appear to a third party. And in fact, they are, because you see, we can take this tiniest little molehill and make an alp out of it in our own minds. And what somebody may not think was any great transgression at all, in our minds it was a monster. And so to be free of that, we ascribe the same kind of monstrosity to that as we would if we'd gone out and killed somebody or committed some heinous crime. Regardless of how we build these things up in our minds, however, we're going to have to do it. Now, just like everything else in our lives, everything else in recovery, it all comes down to this. If I'm afraid to do it, I'm going to write about it. I'm going to tell God about my fear. I'm going to tell God I'm powerless in this case. I need to make this amends, but I'm so afraid to do it. And I need your help. And I need the willingness, and I need your strength and your power, God, to help me do this. And when we use that prayer, we get it. We get it. It's just another time when we're going to take that leap of faith, and it's going to work, and we're going to say, "Wow, that worked again. That worked again." And each time we do that and it works, our faith grows. Now, there's something at the top of page 77 which is so important that we're going to make a little bit of an issue of it, if you don't mind. And this is the example of how the big book is organized or unorganized, as the case may be, because there's stuff that comes up in this book that doesn't seem to have any relevance particularly to the rest of what's around it. It's just kind of like an idea that crops into Bill's head and he writes it down. And I think that's pretty typical of any inspired work. And so, let's look at top of page 77. At the moment, we are trying to put our lives in order. This, of course, is directed to the person who is presently working their steps, right? This is the probably a fairly new person who's reached the ninth step now. At the moment, we're trying to put our lives in order. But this is not an end in itself. Think about that for a second, because it clearly defines the state of mind of so many people when they walk in the door. What I really want out of this is to get back my job, get back my family, get back my reputation, get back my money, my things, whatever. Get back my pride, get back my self-esteem. And we're here because, and we're sticking around here because we think that's going to happen here. And we see the people around us that obviously all this has happened for them. So at the moment, we're trying to put our lives in order, but no. This is not an end in itself. This is one of the most important sentences in the whole big book. Our real purpose, the real purpose in our being here, the real purpose in working the 12 steps, the real purpose God had in mind when he got us in the door, when that great miracle in our lives was worked, where we're given the opportunity for freedom from alcohol. Our real purpose is to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. Notice that does not say to be fit by our sponsor or by our home group or by any other outside influence, certainly not by treatment centers, psychiatrists, or pills, to fit ourselves. This means that this is work that we must do. This is work that we must do to fit ourselves with God's help to be of maximum service to God and the people about us. That's our purpose. That's our holy mission. That's why we are here. And when we understand that, then we understand that we must put all this other stuff aside and concentrate on what the purpose of all this is. Ultimately, it comes down to this. If I fit myself to be of maximum service to God and the people about me, and I, in fact, enter into that service and I perform that mission, my life is going to change. I will have my heritage of happiness, joyousness, and freedom. I'll have that whole new way of life. I'll be restored to sanity. I will be God conscious. I will have a spiritual awakening. And I will continue to have that life so long as I continue to perform my real purpose in life, which is to be of maximum service to God and the people about me. See how this all ties together? It brings us right back down to earth. And there's no fooling around here. There's no weasel words here. It doesn't say, oh golly gee whiz, it'd be kind of nice if we sort of did some few things here to make ourselves look pretty good so that people might listen to us when we told them some fairy story about our past life. We want to be able to carry a message that has depth and weight, because Dr. Silkworth made it clear to us that frothy emotional appeal seldom suffices. The only thing that will interest these alcoholic people, he said, must have depth and weight to it. Depth and weight. Our responsibilities, the work we must perform, and God's place in our lives. Depth and weight. And that's what we have. So next week, then, we will be looking at the... Hold on a minute, Howie. I'll be with you. Next week, then, we will be looking at the ninth step, and we will look at the five different kinds of amends which are set forth in the ninth step, and how we go about making those amends. And now we will hear from Howie. Howie says this is a great contradiction. What?
The real purpose is to fit ourselves to be the best in service to God and the people about us.
Yes?
If we refer back to page 19, none of us makes a sole vocation of this work, nor do we think its effectiveness would be increased if we did. We feel that elimination of our drinking is but a beginning. A much more important demonstration of our principles lies before us in our respective homes, occupations, and affairs. All of us spend much of our spare time in that sort of effort which we are going to describe. A few are fortunate enough to be so situated that they give nearly all their time to the work.
Okay, how is that in conflict, Howie?
Well, it says our real purpose in life...
No, it does not say that. It says our real purpose
is to fit ourselves to be of maximum service to God.
Our real purpose. Okay, Howie, wait a second now. Our real purpose in doing what? Working the steps, Howie.
Well, where does it say that?
That's the subject here. We're talking about the ninth step, which is one of the steps. That's what that means, Howie. Our real purpose in working the steps is to fit ourselves to be a maximum service to God and the people about us. Maximum service means that which we are capable of performing, where we are willing to work and self-sacrifice for others, but not where we're going to sacrifice family or other commitments that we may have. All right, let's go, Douglas. Oh, I got to run. We're not on Thursday night, are we?
No, I was afraid you were going to forget the basket, so I put them out there.
Well, yeah, see, you went and got official on me, so I was going to... All right, let's see. Oh, holy cow, I'm sorry we ran over here. Pardon? Oh, yeah, let Kathy have the basket. Do we got to do the secretary's report? No, okay, because we're running overtime, right? All right, guys, thanks a lot. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together.